Cool. What's up, guys? KS here. Thanks for joining me today, as always. Welcome back to another If I Could Only Have One, this time between the FN 509 Tactical and the Canik Elite Combat. I was a bit surprised at how often this video was requested, but here we are at your suggestion, and thank you for that. Be sure to leave a comment down below and let me know your choice. Now, the series has been on a bit of a hiatus, but I'm glad to bring it back at your request. As a reminder, this series compares two guns, and at the end, yes, there is a winner, but here's the thing. Both of these guns are awesome, and if you're considering either or have either, you're doing great. I love challenging myself and perhaps challenging you to decide, if you could only have one, which one would you choose? Both the FN and Canik fall into an interesting category in the striker-fired segment. They have recognizable names, but neither get the fanfare that other popular brands such as Glock, Smith & Wesson, and Sig Sauer get. I'm not really sure why that is, since both are viable options for many applications. That said, they both are loaded with features and command a somewhat steep price tag. The MSRP on the FN is $1,050 and the Canik is $850. Other than price, there are minor differences between them, but it's definitely a close matchup. Now it's time to take a look and see who wins. Let's jump in. All right, let's take a look at both of these and see how they stack up dimensionally. Now the Canik is going to be on the top of the screen. So in terms of length, both of these are going to be under 8 inches, although you'll notice that the Canik is surprisingly long. I was a little bit surprised by that. I really figured that the 509 would be basically the same length, but that's not true. Now, as far as FN and Canik and what they report on their website, they are just about neck and neck, but I think how they take their measurements are a little bit different. So there you go as far as length. Now, in terms of height, both of these are gonna be a little bit under 6 inches. I'm trying to line them up as best I can. Now, keep in mind that the Canik on your right does have the extended magazine in it. I'll throw the other magazine in here in just a moment so you can get an idea of that, but when I try and line them up top of slide to top of slide, they really are pretty close. Now, in terms of width, there is definitely a little bit of a difference. The 509 on your left is going to be 1.35 inches versus 1.45 inches on the Canik on your right, so definitely a little bit wider. In terms of weight, there's definitely a difference. The 509 is actually quite a bit heavier. It's at 27.9 ounces versus 25.8 ounces on the Canik. So there are your specs right there. It's a pretty interesting lineup for sure. Now, when we talk about magazines, there are some pretty unique things going on. I've got a couple of props here I'm bringing in. There are your props right there. Now the 509 does have these 17 round flat magazine. Now this is a black based one. It does come with the FDE base for the regular gun. I just happen to have an extra magazine. I like that look just a little bit better. But then it also comes with a couple of 24 round magazines. Man, look at this thing. That is quite a rig for sure. So it's pretty interesting that they did that. Now I said in previous videos that I'm not really one to carry something like a 24 round magazine, although you definitely can. It's just not for me, but I'll tell you what, for range use or for duty use of one sort or another, 24 round magazines definitely come in handy. Now the Canik is just a little bit different. Right now it does have the extended magazine in it, and this base plate right here is going to be a +3 base plate. It's pretty interesting. Now I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that this is a Canik base plate. It's not from Salient. And the rest of the Canik stuff, there are definitely some Salient options on there. But when I put in the 15 round flat magazine, I have to say, this is not a very good look. I think it looks a little bit awkward, especially with that threaded barrel in it. So I really would have liked to have seen Canik throw in 2, if not 3, of these magazines. It just looks better, and you get 3 more rounds with it. So there is form and function in that. That's just me though. I'm sure, and there could be actually some options out there for this already, but at the time when I did the original film, there definitely wasn't that option. All right, we're gonna set the Canik aside for a while. We will come back and visit it again here in a moment, but let's take a look at the features of the 509. Now, we always start with the grips, of course, and in terms of grip texture, the 509, I would say, is a medium aggressive grip texture. It's got several different textures that it provides for you, and some of which I really like. I love this texture up here. It's just, it breaks up that grip a little bit, and it's actually very comfortable. So it is certainly usable, especially for somebody that has oily hands like I have. And then it also does have interchangeable back straps. It comes with two. I think there actually is a third out there that you can get, if I'm not mistaken, but the fact is it only comes with two. That's fine. At least it gives you a little bit of flexibility in there. And then there is actually a little bit of a cutout so you can strip out magazines if you need to. I love that feature. I wish all guns came with that. It's just really nice to be able to take care of any malfunctions if you need to. Now, in terms of magazine release, we've got a really nice magazine release. They've changed it a little bit for the 509 Tactical, and it works a lot better than it did before. It's ambi out of the box. I mean, it's very comfortable. It's light enough that you can actuate it very easily. I remember the original 509, that magazine release was pretty stiff, so I think they've made some modifications based upon user feedback. And then the slide lock slide release, again, is ambidextrous. It works very well as both, and I like the fact that they included that. And then in terms of takedown, it does have your takedown lever. You do need to lock the slide back. You'd swing your lever, put the slide home, and then you do have to pull the trigger. I don't take the guns apart in these if I could only have ones. You'll have to go back to the original video for that. I did take it apart. And then to round out your frame, we do have an accessory rail for lights, lasers, tiny ninjas, that sort of thing. It's a nice size rail, so you can really put on just about any toy you want to. So that's your frame on the 509. The slide on the 509 definitely has some interesting characteristics. First, you'll notice that there are front and rear serrations. And I will tell you, even with my oily hands, they do work. You can definitely get a purchase on them. And there's a little bit of millwork here just to break up the lines on the slide. I love the color combination as well. I like the fact that they don't match slide to frame. It kind of reminds me of the SCAR rifle, that sort of thing. We do have our FN logo, and it does say 509. I think it is very tasteful. It's well done. But the thing that grabs your attention pretty much right off the bat are these wings right here that actually shroud your rear sights. And I'll get to the sights in a moment. But this is cut for a red dot, and it comes with a variety of different plates like these little guys right here. So you can mount pretty much any of your popular red dots on it, and the system is really unique. There's actually an O-ring that sits inside here, and the purpose for that is to be able to put on your red dot and not worry about Loctite, because the O-ring works against the pressure of the screws, so it keeps it in place. And I have tested it a number of times, and it seems to work very well. Now, these wings also serve another purpose. They actually protect that rear sight. There are actually some little ledges, little notches right there, so you can do any one-handed manipulation, something like that, and you're not actually bumping into the rear sight at all. And speaking of sights, we do have raised tritium sights. Get you a good look at that front sight, and then your back sight as well. These sights are fantastic. I love the HD callout, even though it's not yellow or orange or red or anything like that. It still proved to be very easy to pick up at the range, and I think really in any lighting condition. So it's a great sight setup. I like that top of the slide. I think it really looks very nice. And then to top it all off, we do have a threaded barrel. Now, this is a 1/2 by 28 or 28 by 1/2. I can never remember, but that's the thread pitch. It's a pretty common thread pitch if you're going to be running a can, which I have several times on this, and it's just proven to be a great suppressor hose. So it's a very nice package altogether that FN has put together with the 509 Tactical. I really like it quite a bit. As we walk around the Canik, there are definitely some differences between it and the 509. Now, one thing that stands out pretty quickly is actually the magwell, not only the base plate, of course, but the magwell, and this is from Salient Arms. I love this. It's a great addition. Now, I'll talk a little bit more about it in the shooting experience, but I think it's a great add-on. I wish more guns came with something like this. Now, you'll notice that the backstrap is black, which is pretty cool. It breaks things up, and it is also interchangeable. So it comes with a couple of backstraps, leaning to a little bit of modularity. But as we look at the grip texture on this, kind of shove it in your face for a moment, the side panels, they could be more aggressive. I would say this is pretty light aggressive. I think it looks nice, but it just doesn't bite as well as the 509. Now, the front and rear texture, it's not quite so bad, and the gun still stayed pretty planted in the hand. It wasn't that big of a deal, but again, a little bit more texture would be good. But the rest of the ergos are really nice. It's very comfortable in the hand. Now, as far as the magazine release, you'll notice it actually sticks out quite a ways, if you can see that. This is the medium one. The Canik comes with actually a box of goodies, kind of like the TP9 SFX. There are a couple of different magazine release button heights that you can get. So this is medium, it's got a small and a large, and it is swappable, though not ambient out of the box. But I love the fact that I can keep my shooting grip, I don't have to change a thing, and this button, the medium one that comes on it, works really well. So I think that's kind of nice, it's a good add-on to have some swappability with those buttons. Now the slide lock slide release is ambi, which is good. It's a huge paddle and it worked very well at the range, and it doesn't get in the way of the shooting experience at all. So I like the controls. I think they've done a really good job with this. Now in terms of takedown, it does have your takedown buttons or tabs, kind of like a Glock, something like that. You do have to pull the trigger, then you'll pull your slide back about an eighth of an inch and pull your tabs down, and then you can release the slide. It's good to go. So very easy user maintenance, that sort of thing. And then we do have a little bit more grip texture right here, just as a reference point on both sides. I like that as well. And a little bit of grip texture in front of the trigger guard, which the 509 does not have. And it also has your accessory rail for all of your popular toys. So in terms of the frame, I think they've done a really good job. As we move up the slide, you'll notice that there are also front and rear serrations. One thing I've noticed, because I don't know if this is some sort of Cerakote coating or something like that, or PVD, whatever it happens to be, but it's a little bit more slick, and these serrations, although they look good, they aren't very usable to me. I need to depend on the rear serration. So I like the fact that they break up the slide. It's fine, but just not as usable as on the FN. The millwork is very nice. I mean, I think the slide is attractive, if nothing else. And then we've got a couple of different banners on both sides. Now, I could do without some of the extra banner stuff. I would like it to be a little bit more subtle, but still, it's black. It kind of breaks things up, and that's fine. It's not a big deal. Now you'll also notice, like the 509, there is a cutout for red dots, which is pretty cool, and it comes with a variety of plates like this guy right here, so you can swap it out for any of your popular red dots, again like the 509, but there is one big difference. You'll notice that on the plate is the rear sight. Unlike the 509, you do lose your rear co-witness with this, and I know people say that some red dots come with a little bit of a cutout so you can still co-witness, and that's fine, but I would rather have my rear sight and have the red dot. It's not a deal breaker for me necessarily if this is going to be a range toy, something like that. However, for carry option or go to battle, anything like that, I would want that co-witness, that true co-witness on there. And speaking of sights, it's another salient add-on. These are the fiber optic sights. I love these sights. They pick up very nicely at the range. There's a little bit of serration on the front, and then we've got a totally blacked out rear. So as far as target sights go, these things are fantastic. Now they're not night sights, unlike the 509, but they still are fantastic. And then one last thing, another salient add-on is the threaded barrel. Now this is a European thread pitch, so it's a little different from the 509. You'll need a different adapter for your can. I have not run this with a can. I don't have that adapter, and I really haven't wanted to spend the money on another adapter. I already have several, so I may do that down the road. But again, otherwise, this package actually is really nice. The shooting experience with both guns is a ton of fun. The FN, with its full-size grip, allows the shooter to have full control, and the bright raised tritium sights are very easy to pick up in any lighting condition. With the addition of the threaded barrel, the 509 makes for an awesome suppressor host as well. It comes with the extra recoil spring and guide rods, so it can handle any ammo type with ease. The trigger, though not light, is crisp and predictable. With the addition of the Apex system, it's truly dialed in. One thing I did find, however, is that the 509 seems to be a bit more top-heavy, which leads to more muzzle flip in my hands, though when measuring them side by side, there's hardly a difference. I'm sure it's the shooter in this case. The Canik is a flat-out awesome shooter. Like the 509, the sights track well and are easy to pick up, though you don't have the raised night sight capabilities with the Elite. If you've been watching the channel lately, you've picked up on the fact that I'm really liking magwells. It's such a little thing, but it can make a huge difference in grip and control. Aside from the aid of the magwell, I seem to be able to get a slightly higher grip on the Canik, which also translates into more control, especially for quicker follow-up shots. As for the trigger, well, it's unbelievable. Most spend lots of money and time tuning a trigger to be like this, but Canik has done it right out of the box. Now, one thing the Elite would benefit from is just a little more grip texture. For someone with oily hands like me, this can be a real deal breaker. All right, I made a pretty crazy claim about the Canik trigger during the shooting footage, So let's take a look and see how the 509 stacks up for a moment or two. Now, right off the bat, you'll notice this is actually an Apex trigger. I switched it out for the original stock hinged design, which I do not like at all. So this is not really a review on the Apex trigger itself. I have one in the video library if you're curious, but just for the sake of argument, it is a flat trigger. It does have the safety lever in the middle. Now, I'll tell you what, the take up on this, it's cleaned up quite a bit. It used to be really gritty, but it is definitely a lot better. So we do get to our wall right here, and then our brake. Our brake is fantastic. It's a lot lighter. It's more crisp than the original trigger. It feels much better. And it's coming in about 5.25 pounds or so, a little bit better. So it continues to lighten up and smooth out as well. And then our reset is right there. Now, one thing I complain about with this trigger is the reset spring. It's really, it's weak. I wish it was a little bit more bold so it would chuck that trigger out a little bit better. But now we are back at the wall. And there's our brake again. We'll do this one more time with our reset. And there's your reset. It's audible, it's crisp again, and then we're back out to the start. So really, as far as triggers go, now that I've got the Apex in it, it's fantastic. Out of the box, the stock trigger was good, but it was far more duty oriented, and this one just has cleaned up quite a bit. In terms of triggers with the Canik, now this is totally stock, and I know people like to give me a little bit of grief when I don't have stock triggers for these comparisons. Guys, it's what I have to work with. So definitely go back to the original video on that 509 to talk about that trigger. But this one is, it's not a Salient upgrade, it's actually a Canik upgrade. So it's a little different than maybe the TP9 SF Elite, something like that. You'll notice it's a flat trigger with the red safety lever in it. I think it's a great looking trigger. I think it's a great feeling trigger as well. But let's pull this thing and see what it's like. So there's our take up right there. It's about the same distance actually as the 509. So not a lot of difference. It's very smooth. I can feel that spring working a little bit, but then there's your wall. And there's your brake again, light and crisp. I mean, this thing is absolutely fantastic. It's a little bit more of a 4.25 pound trigger, and it just feels great. Now this reset, you blink and you miss it. The reset is so short. And then we are at the wall. That's something I love about this trigger. I mean, that spring is great. It's fast. It's crisp. It's light. It just feels awesome. I don't like to rant and rave about triggers, but when I find a trigger out of the box that's stock that feels this good, it's really actually pretty exciting to me. So guys, here we are at the end, and it's an if I could only have one video, so there must be a winner. A couple of things though. I said it before and I'll say it again. Both of these guns are fantastic. I own them both. I'm invested in both, so there's no bias at all. Occasionally, I get accused of being biased because somebody doesn't agree with my choice. Guys, it couldn't be further from the truth. I love all guns, and there's something to take from each one that's fantastic. But again, I have to pick a winner in this. So it's been a challenge, but it's also been a lot of fun. Now the FN comes with a lot of features. There's a lot to like going on with it. First, it comes with 3 magazines, 2 of which are 24 round. That's outstanding. The other magazine being 17 rounds. It's got the threaded barrel. It's a really fun can host. It's got the raised sights. It's got the cut for the RMR or red dot rather. And you can use RMRs or anything else like that. So there's a lot of flexibility, a lot of modularity. It's got a nice soft case that comes with it as well. So there is a ton to like about it. Now, one thing that I didn't care for too much in the beginning was the trigger. The Apex definitely cleaned that up quite a bit, but out of the box, the trigger on the 509, whether it be the tactical or the regular, just wasn't necessarily for me, so the shooting experience wasn't quite as good. That said, it's a fantastic package. Now, at $1,050 MSRP, and yes, I know you can get it for less than that street price, it is a pricey gun, so it's certainly a big investment for people, especially when they have other choices out there. You might not get as many options when you're paying less with those other choices, but it's still something that people consider. That said, the FN 509 is a fantastic gun. Now, the one thing that heavily influenced me with this, if I could only have one, was the shooting experience. And although the 509 is a great shooter, there's no doubt, the Canik is phenomenal, and a couple of reasons for that. The trigger is ridiculous. Out of the box, that trigger, it really is dialed in the way I like a trigger. The magwell helps with the grip quite a bit, and I feel like I can get my hands just a little higher on the gun, so there's less muzzle flip. It just stays a little flatter in my hands as well. Now, the Canik is certainly not perfect. There are couple things that I would change. The thread pitch on the barrel, even though I like the look of the Salient barrel, that thread pitch drives me nuts. I'd rather have a common thread pitch here in the US that we normally use. It would make it a lot cheaper and easier to throw a can on it. With the red dot, although it's cut for it and you can use any of your different red dots like the 509, you lose that rear sight. Now for me, with this application, I'm not going to be carrying it. It's not a home defense gun. It's a range gun. So losing the rear sight, although a bummer, and a bummer for a lot of people, for my taste, it's not that big of a deal. So I'll ding the gun for it, but at the same time, the reality of it for me, it's not a deal breaker. But when I think of the rest of the package of the Canik 509, especially that trigger and the magwell, it's just fantastic. Yes, there are only two magazines that come with it. There's less capacity, no doubt about it. But again, this is a range gun for me, so that's a heavy influence on me as well. So guys, at the end of the day, if I could only have one, yes, it would be the Canik, but only barely. And if I was thinking of it from a carry or home defense type of situation, I would go with the 509 all day long. It wouldn't even be a thought, but that's just not where I'm coming from with this. And the shooting experience with the Canik is truly fantastic. So there you have it, guys. I know a lot of people are gonna disagree with me. I can't wait to read the comments and see what you guys think and think about the type of application that you're gonna be using these two guns with. So I'm really curious. Be sure to leave those comments down below and sound off. I'm excited to read those. Otherwise, thanks so much for joining me, and I will see you next time.